Hello, I'm Jill Lublin, author of Guerrilla Publicity, Networking Magic, and my newest book, Get Noticed, Get Referrals on McGraw-Hill. Welcome to Messages of Hope from Around the World. I'm here tonight to inspire you. And our guest on Messages of Hope is Kristine Carlson. Hello and welcome.
Good evening. Hi, how are you?
Doing great. And Kristine is the author of An Hour to Live, An Hour to Love. She's also the wife of the esteemed Richard Carlson, who wrote the series Don't Sweat the Small Stuff. So Kristine, let's just jump right in, shall we?
All right.
I mean, everybody's probably wondering, let's just get to it. What happened to Richard?
Well, Richard got on a flight December 13th, 2006, 18 months ago, and he was healthy and well as far as we knew, and on the descent of a flight to New York City, 5-hour flight, hit a pulmonary embolism, and he died instantly.
That's amazing. I mean, you know, that's that old thing about you just never know, do you?
No, you don't.
Yeah, and he was such an amazing author and such a motivational
person. He's an amazing man.
Yes, and you had the blessing of living and loving him for how long?
For 25 years.
Oh, so, how magnificent.
Yeah, it was, we had an amazing life together. It was incredible. It was really a fairy tale, everything, until December 13th. So.
Well, but the good news is you had that much time together.
We did, yeah.
And I understand during that time you also were part of the Don't Sweat the Small Stuff series. Is that true? Meaning you did one for women?
Yeah, there were 8 books in the series, and we wrote Don't Sweat the Small Stuff in Love together, and which was just an incredible part of our journey as a married couple. We always used to joke and say that every couple should write a book on love together.
And why is that? Were you fighting most of the time?
No, actually we weren't. But, you know, it's just a great tool for communication, and that was sort of the spirit that we wrote it in, was so that it would help other people communicate the way that we did.
Yes. Well, how magnificent that is. And how did you communicate? I mean, what would you share about how to communicate effectively, whether you're in a couple or any relationship?
Well, I think that in relationship, especially a married relationship, there were a couple things that Richard and I always held at the very highest priority list for us, was to always respect each other and always listen to each other. And I think we both, we listened to the feeling behind the statements that we would make sometimes, instead of taking the content of what somebody says to you directly and personally. You can listen to their feeling, what's really behind, how are they feeling about themselves right now. And that's sort of what we did in our relationship on a day-to-day basis. And we were just really amazing partners together. Like, we sort of live life like tossing a ball back and forth to each other. And of course, that's what I'm missing most now, is, you know, my best friend and my partner. So
yes. Well, can you give me an example of some of that listening beyond what's being spoken?
Yeah, you know, everyone in life has their ups and downs, or their moments of, you know, where they're just sort of dismayed at life, or they're frustrated. But I think the key thing in having a great relationship is to really notice when the person that you're in your relationship with is feeling taken for granted. Like, for example, I'll remember a time when Richard was really traveling a lot, and he would come home, and we sat down, and he was frustrated. And I remember thinking about, okay, hearing that he was frustrated, and I remember saying to myself, just hear his frustration, and don't take personally what he says, whether it's right or wrong, or you're, and just stay neutral with it, and listen to the fact that he's frustrated. And then what I heard from him was that he was not feeling appreciated. And
by you?
Or yeah, just in, by me in general, in our relationship or whatever. I mean, maybe he wasn't feeling appreciated in life, who knows, you know? But I just remember knowing that that was a moment for me to, you know, say to him how much I really appreciated him, and to acknowledge what he was saying, but not to take defensively what he was saying.
Right, and that's in any relationship, whether at work, whether in a primary relationship or a friendship. I think always to listen from that perspective is so powerful. I mean, would you say that's part of not sweating the small stuff? I mean, what does that really mean, don't sweat the small stuff? So it's a great book title.
Yeah.
What does it mean?
Yeah, well, Don't Sweat the Small Stuff is about not letting the little things get to you in life and not letting the little things take over your life, but really realizing that there are big things that happen in life, like when somebody dies, that is a big thing. But, you know, to Richard now, it really is all small stuff. You know, he is not a human anymore, but he's still a being in my mind. You know, that's how I go on. And I think the beauty of An Hour to Live is that Richard wrote this 3 years prior to his passing, and he wrote this as a letter to me to tribute our love, and then I actually published it as a tribute to him. But the main message in this book is to live life presently, to take stock of, you know, everything that is important to you at this moment right now, and take the time to tell the people that you love them. And as Richard did, he wrote to me everything that he would say in his last hour of life, answering the question, if you had an hour to live, who would you call, why are you waiting, and what would you say?
And so he said in that letter the things to you that he would say
in his last hour of life.
And what did he say?
Well, he, first of all, he very brilliantly talked about who he wouldn't call in that last hour, and he said he wouldn't call his accountant, his attorney, or, you know, anybody like that. And, you know, basically he talked about his priorities in life, about, you know, what mattered to him most were the things that we shared as a couple, simple things like he would come home from work and we would go out into the garden and just enjoy watching the sunset or enjoy sitting with our sunflowers. And he really drives home the basics of life, that to think about the things that you really are going to be thinking about in your last hour are not generally the things that we all worry about day to day, and they're not the things that we make so important. They're the things that really are important to us, like who's in our life and who we love, you know, those are.
So how do you take stock of that? I mean, you know, you have to live this message day in and day out, even with this, we'll call it, you know, this tragedy, this sadness that happened to this soulmate of yours, and yet you have to keep moving, and I'm sure there are days when maybe you're feeling a little down, or what do you do?
Oh, well, yeah, down doesn't describe the kind of grief that I've been through in the last year and a half. I mean, it's devastating grief. Mm-hmm. Yet, when you stay really present with life, you know, and that is the greatest lesson of this book, and anything that Richard ever tried to impart was to live this moment to its fullest and stay present. And the beauty of grief, I have to say, is that it opens you to a place of presence that you may never know otherwise, and that you don't want to live. You can't dwell in your past. Like, if I spent every waking moment thinking about what I'm missing, do you think I'd be sitting here with you? No. I'd be downing a fifth of vodka and a pack of cigarettes a day. You know?
That's probably not too healthy.
No, and I won't do that. But that's what people do when they don't acknowledge their grief, or they don't, you know, realize that, you know, you have to live presently. You can't live in the future and you can't live in the past. You have to live right now.
So if you were to encapsulate, we'll call it a message of hope, mm-hmm. what would you say?
I would say a couple of things. I would say that to not be afraid of life and what life holds, that even in the worst tragedy, and losing Richard was one of my absolute three worst nightmares. I have two daughters. And that would have been far worse to go through losing one of them. Mm-hmm. But I would say that tragedy, you know intuitively how to grieve, you know intuitively how to live on in the face of loss, and that tragedy has something in it for you. It has gifts, it has a way of opening you to life. And you know, my hope is for anyone that goes through anything hard that their life will have greater meaning.
Beautiful.
At the end of it.
Thank you. That was beautifully mm-hmm. said.
Thank you.
I would love, although we'll be going on, but would you please give people your email and ways to connect with you?
The best way, if they wanted to connect with me, would be to email me at info@don'tsweat.com.
Thank you. And then if you want to connect with me, you can email me to info@jilllublin.com. Now, let's keep going about this 1 hour to live, because realistically, in a certain way, that's all we really ever have, right? I mean, to...
Oh, absolutely.
You never know.
You never know when your time is. And yeah, and if you really truly lived presently, you would live every moment as if it was your last.
So he was 45, right?
45.
You're pretty young.
Very young.
Yeah. And I'm sure shocking to you. Like, what do you mean my husband died, right? Because I've read some articles about you and what happened as you received that call. And, you know, like, you got to be kidding. You thought it was a joke.
Yeah.
So here, if we all have an hour to live, and obviously you've been out there continuing his legacy, and I admire you for that. And so as you're in front of people, what are you reminding them to do? I mean, besides being present, you know, obviously, and thinking about that, what do you think are other things that we should remember to do? And all right, take away the should, but that we can be doing every day?
Well, I think that living presently is about, I mean, I don't know how to say that in a nutshell, except that when you breathe, you are present. And if there was one exercise that anyone could do to increase their presence, it would be to just sit in silence and breathe. And every breath that you take, every time you do it and you become consciously aware of it, that brings your focus to the presence. But stillness and quiet, and not busying ourselves, and not, you know, those are all things that people can do to increase their presence.
Well, and that's something I think in these times is actually very challenging, very demanding.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You know, how do you do it? I mean, I'm sure you have a very full schedule. What do you do? Where do you put it in your day? Do you have any kind of routine?
You know, since Richard died, I have actually, I really don't schedule myself so fully, because when you're in grief, you need time to just be quiet. You know, I didn't watch TV. I didn't watch the news. I didn't read the newspaper for the first full year after his passing. I completely needed to push aside all of the stimulus that was around me. But you know, there's so much beauty in slowing down. You know, because then you start to wake up to all the life around you, and you like go outside and the sky is just exploding. You know, you're feeling the trees, you're feeling life everywhere when you slow down like that. Mm-hmm. And it's a beautiful experience to have had that. I mean, I was, you know, we've always lived a very fast-paced life, and you know, I plan to, even amidst a busy schedule, to take time to just really be quiet.
Yeah, I think it really is the only thing, right?
Yeah.
It's interesting, because sometimes, I mean, I actually fractured both ankles.
Oh, wow, you were forced to slow
yes.
down.
Yes, God literally yeah. stopped me in my tracks, and yeah. sometimes I think if you don't slow down, there will be something in the physical world that will stop you.
Oh, without a doubt, I believe that we are all a universe inside, and we just draw in everything from the inside out. I mean,
yeah. Well, I'm curious, and you know, I don't know if you can, shall we say, just speak a line or two from the book, just something from his words to share with our viewers. Is there anything that you remember or recall that you could share as a line or two?
Well, I think, yeah, I mean, he talks about how poignant it is that time really flies, you know, and, you know, it's such a personal letter to me. I, of course, haven't memorized it.
A personal letter that you're sharing with the whole
yeah,
world now.
Yeah, it is, yeah, and it's the whole thing is, it's all, there's not one particular line in there. The whole thing is just, it's everything that, I mean, Richard was considered one of the foremost happiness experts in the world, and it's everything that meant anything to him. So it's rich in every line.
And your heart, when you think of him, where does it go?
My heart just goes to pure love.
What a beautiful thing to be able to say. And I'm just yeah. curious too, and I'm sure people are wondering, like, what was your secret to happiness with him as a couple? What would you recommend?
Well, I think